Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. If you'd like any of your Ramadan related questions answered this month, you can email us at questions@amau.org.
وأقول في القرآن ما جاءت به آياته فهو الكريم المنزال. وأقول قال الله جل جلاله والمصطفى الهادي ولا أتأول.
The question we're going to be answering today is as follows. Is a woman allowed to read the Quran when she is menstruating and can she touch the Mus'haf?
الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على عبد الله ورسوله نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. This matter is a matter about which the scholars differed, or these two matters that have been asked about are matters about which the scholars differed. So let's look at the first issue, which is the issue of recitation. So we're not talking about the Mus'haf or not the Mus'haf, we're talking about reciting the Quran generally. And as we said, it's a matter in which the scholars differed, but the correct opinion, inshallah ta'ala, is that it is permissible for a woman on her menses to recite the Quran. And this is the madhab of the Malikiyya and the Zahiriyya, and it is narrated from Al-Imam al-Shafi'i in his old, fil qadim, yani in the old opinion from him. And it is a narration from Al-Imam Ahmad, and it was the opinion of Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, ibn al-Qayyim, and it is what is given, the fatwa is given in that regard by the Lajna al-Da'imah, the permanent committee in our time. And Al-Imam al-Nawawi, he mentioned this, he said, حَكَى الْخُرَاسَانِيُّونَ قولا قديما للشافعي أنه يجوز لها قراءة القرآن. He said the Khurasani people, they mentioned from a Shafi'i, an opinion which is an old opinion of a Shafi'i, that it is allowed for her to recite the Quran. And they basically mentioned two potential reasons for this. Now, to understand this, the difference, we have to actually understand where this issue came from. The issue actually came from the one who is junub, the one who is in a state of impurity after intercourse or something similar to that, a person who is in a state of impurity, who is junub, not being allowed to recite the Quran. This in itself is an issue in which there is ikhtilaf between the people of knowledge, the scholars differed about. But if we say that the junub is prevented, they said the junub is prevented from reading the Quran, so likewise the menstruating woman should be prevented from reading the Quran. As for this old opinion from a Shafi'i, and now we mentioned two possible reasons with regard to the illah, the reason why this might be allowed. He said if we take it as a basis that it's not allowed for the junub, then why might we allow it for the woman on her menses? One of them is that she has a long time. Her menses last a long time. So she could be made to or caused to forget the Quran because of the length of time, and that long length of time without reciting the Quran. And likewise, she might be teaching the Quran either to her children or to other children, and so it might harm her in that regard and harm her students in that regard as well. But in any case, the correct opinion in this regard is that she is permitted to recite whenever she wants. And one of the major differences is that she does not have the ability to remove the state of impurity from herself. As for the junub, they only need to go in the shower. They only need to take a bath. The matter is in their hands and it's easy for them. As for her, she doesn't have the ability to remove that state from herself. It's going to be with her until the menses end. And therefore, because of that, the two are not the same. Also, bear in mind that we haven't even discussed the issue of whether this is even true for the junub to even begin with. So we're going to say that we don't see there to be any issue with this, and we're going to take the opinion of, as we said, the Malikiyya and those who followed them in this, and it's a riwayah, as we said, from Imam Shafi'i, from Imam Ahmad, and it's the opinion of Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah and Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahumullah ta'ala, and it is what is considered to be the standard fatwa that was given out by the Lajna al-Da'imah, the permanent committee in our time, and this is what we feel is closest to the evidence, and Allah Azza wa Jalla knows best, that she can recite the Quran whenever she wants during that time of menses. As for touching the Mus'haf, then the madhahib al-arba'ah, the four madhahib, being the Hanafiyya and the Malikiyya, the Shafi'iyya and the Hanabila, they all took the opinion that it is not permissible for the Ha'id to touch the Mus'haf. And they brought some different evidences for this. There's no doubt this is the opinion of Jumhur al-Ulama, the vast majority of the scholars. And they brought some different opinions for this. They brought famously the ayah, لَا يَمَسُّهُ إِلَّا الْمُطَّهَّرُونَ, no one touches it except for the pure. Even though Al-Imam Malik in his Muwatta, he brought he showed that his opinion was that this ayah is not a correct evidence for this issue. Al-Imam Malik, he didn't support using the ayah, and he instead relied upon a hadith in this regard. So in any case, and the matter is one which the vast majority of scholars, they said it is not permissible for her to touch the Mus'haf. And in this, even though the issue is not a closed issue, it's not an issue which there can be no debate about, and it's an issue which some of our mashayikh and the scholars of Islam, they spoke strongly about. And among them is Sheikh Al-Albani, rahimahullah ta'ala, who spoke extensively on this issue, that there is no reason to prevent her from touching the Mus'haf. However, it being the opinion of the overwhelming majority of the scholars and all of the four madahib, the four madahib faqhiyah, I think that al-ahwat, the safer opinion, and the opinion that you feel content and safe within your heart, is that she shouldn't touch the Mus'haf. That's the safer opinion. Even though we don't think that this ayah, and Allah Azza wa Jalla knows best, is a strong evidence for that, to put forward that opinion, in terms of the tafsir of the ayah. But the fact that there is a hadith in this regard, and I know there is a difference also about the meaning of at-tahir. Is it the tahara as in the word, the meaning of a Muslim, or does it mean someone who is mutatahhir, who is making wudu themselves and so on? But we're going to simplify it and say that when it comes to her reading the Quran, there is no harm in her reading the Quran. When it comes from to the issue of touching the Mus'haf, then we think this is not permissible in the safer of the two opinions. And we would say then, what is the alternative? Well, the alternative is anything which is not a Mus'haf. And the Mus'haf is that which is the Arabic copy of the Qur'an. The Arabic Qur'an, you know, the one that you take from the shelf and it's completely Arabic. That's the Mus'haf. That's what we call a Mus'haf. As for a book of tafsir, we don't call this a Mus'haf. And as for a translation where there's Arabic and English, we don't call this a Mus'haf, even if some of the people of knowledge, they distinguish, is it mostly Arabic or is it mostly the Arabic Mus'haf and just a few words on the side, then it should be considered a Mus'haf. You know how you have those Masahif with just a few words on the side. But generally, if it's a mix of a Mus'haf and tafsir, or a Mus'haf and translation, like that Arabic and translation and things like that, or reading from the phone or the tablet or the computer, then inshallah, this is inshallah the easier matter. So to read from the phone, from the tablet, from a book of tafsir or something similar to that, inshallah ta'ala, that's safer. And always, generally, I believe that there's no harm in being safe in these issues. When it doesn't really cause anyone any great harm or distress, and it's not particularly difficult, then inshallah ta'ala, it is better to be safe, bearing in mind this is the opinion of the overwhelming majority of the scholars of Islam. And Allah Azza wa Jalla knows best. Wassalatu wassalam ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in.